Hello friends, I am Dr. Ajay Yadav. So today we'll be discussing some of the very important images. You know that images has become so important nowadays that you see quite number of questions based on images. So I have tried my best to incorporate the important images, and then I'll be discussing salient features related to those images. So this is a cylinder, and this is oxygen cylinder, and how you identify oxygen cylinder based on the color. So actually three things which are very important about cylinders is the color, pressure and pin index. So color is not only important from questions point of view, color is also very important from clinical point of view. Why? Because color is the only criteria to identify a cylinder. So if you know the color, then only you can identify a cylinder. So three important cylinders that are being used, and so most important is oxygen, and oxygen is stored in cylinder which are black color, or you can say black body with white shoulders. Nitrous oxide is stored in blue color cylinders, and third you can remember is Antonov's, which is a mixture of 50% oxygen and 50% nitrous oxide. So the color is blue body, and blue body indicates nitrous oxide with white shoulders. So the white shoulders indicate oxygen. So just to summarize, oxygen is stored in cylinders with black body with white shoulders. Nitrous oxide stored in blue color cylinders. Antonox, which is a mixture of 50% oxygen and 50% nitrous oxide, is stored in cylinders with blue body, and I told you blue body indicates nitrous oxide with white shoulders, and white shoulders indicates oxygen. So obviously, needless to say, this is oxygen cylinder. You can see black body with white top or white shoulders. Okay, this cylinder is nitrous oxide blue. This also actually nitrous oxide, but I think due to shade the color is appearing little black, but in fact it is also blue. So I think there's some technical color error. This is also nitrous oxide cylinder, blue body. And this, I told you, third cylinder, that is Antonox, which is a mixture of 50% oxygen and 50% nitrous oxide. So this is blue body, you can see, and this is white shoulders. And the use of Antonox is only for labor analgesia. Labor analgesia, painless labor. You can see this mask. So this pregnant patient, she inhales by herself this Antonox to relieve her pain during labor. Now second thing I told you, which is very important about cylinders, is the pressure. One is the color, second very important thing about cylinder that you should know is the pressure. Because if you know the pressure, then only you can know that how much cylinder, whether the cylinder is full, empty or half full, like that. So regarding pressure, in your books you will see so many units being used: Pascal, kilopascal, mbar, mmHg, torr, because different countries are using different pressure units. But obviously, you know, you need not remember about other countries, you have to remember about India. And in India, the two units which are used are किलोग्राम पर सेंटीमीटर स्क्वायर एंड पाउंड्स पर स्क्वायर इंच, PSI, पाउंड पर स्क्वायर इंच. सो 1 किलोग्राम पर सेंटीमीटर इज इक्वल टू अराउंड 14.1 PSI. सो यू कैन रिमेंबर इन वन यूनिट एंड व्हेन रिक्वायर्ड यू कैन कन्वर्ट. So pressure in oxygen cylinder is 2000 pounds per square inch. If you divide by 14, so in kilogram per centimeter square, it will come around 140 kilogram per centimeter square. Nitrous oxide, the pressure is 760 pounds per square inch, 760 PSI. Antonox, the pressure is 2000 PSI. And why 2000 PSI? Because I told you that Antonox is the mixture of 50% oxygen, 50% nitrous oxide. So it will exhibit the pressure of oxygen. And why? That's a very simple rule of physics. That you know that when you mix two gases with different pressures, the combination always exhibits the pressure of higher gas. That is why Antonox is exhibiting the pressure of oxygen. Okay, so just to summarize, oxygen, the pressure is 2000 PSI, and if they ask in kilogram per centimeter square, you have to simply divide by 14, so it will come around 140. Nitrous oxide, the pressure is 760 pounds per square inch, and Antonox, the pressure is 2000 PSI. Now, I told you three things which you have to remember about cylinder. One is the color, second is the pressure, and third is the pin index. Actually, pin index is not the part of cylinder. It is the part of anesthesia machine, and it is related to cylinders or related to gases. So, what this pin index is? Actually, they have devised 7 pinpoint positions. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, the part of the anesthesia machine where cylinders get fitted, that part is called as yoke. And these pins are present at yoke. Now, what is the significance of this pin? This pin index is basically to prevent a wrong fitting of cylinders. So at the yoke of the oxygen, and yoke, just I told you, is the part where anesthesia where the cylinders get fitted. Now we say that yoke of oxygen is 2-5. That means at the yoke of oxygen, the two pins will be placed at a position of 2 and the position of 5, and at the same corresponding distance there will be holes in oxygen cylinder. So this is the part of the cylinders. So in this diagram you are seeing the part of the cylinder which will be fitted into the anesthesia machine. So at the yoke of oxygen, these two pins will be at these holes will be at a position of 2 and 5. Now nitrous oxide, we say pin index position is 3-5. That means at the yoke of nitrous oxide, two pins will be at a position of 3 and the position of 5. Similarly, in cylinder, the holes in nitrous oxide cylinder will be at the position of 3 and the position of 5. So, if you try to fit nitrous oxide at the place of oxygen, will you be able to? No, because pins and holes will not match with each other. So this is a very, very important protective mechanism, because by chance, if somebody fits nitrous oxide at the place of oxygen and patient receive 100% nitrous oxide, the patient is definitely going to die. So this pin index system is a very, very important protective mechanism to prevent the wrong fitting of cylinders. Now, pin index position for different gases at the yoke of oxygen, the two pins are placed at a position of 2 and 5. At nitrous oxide, they are placed at a position of 3 and 5. And Antonox has only single pin at a position of 7. So just to summarize, pin index position for different gases, oxygen, the two pins are placed at a position of 2 and 5, and at the same corresponding distance there will be holes in oxygen cylinder. Nitrous oxide, the two pins at anesthesia machine are placed at a position of 3 and 5, and at the same 3-5 distance there will be holes in nitrous oxide cylinder. And Antonox has only single pin at a position of 7. Now this is anesthesia machine. In fact, nowadays anesthesia machine is called as anesthesia workstation. Anesthesia machine is called as anesthesia workstation. Why workstation? Because everything is available consolidated at one place. See, this is a monitor which can be fitted with the anesthesia machine. This is ventilator, which you can say is a very integral part of anesthesia machine. And these you can see are the drawers or tray to keep your anesthesia equipment which will be using during anesthesia. So single unit work as workstation. So now anesthesia machines are called as anesthesia workstations. So just to tell you the parts, cylinders and central supply. You know that larger hospitals where consumption of gases is more, it is not possible to change cylinder every time. So there gases are supplied through central supply. There is a central supply room, and through that central supply, oxygen and nitrous oxide is directly delivered to the anesthesia machine. And you must have seen different color pipes are coming which are directly attached to the anesthesia machine. So they are attached in the back. So, or you can say yoke is in the back, so you will not be able to see from the front. Then from the cylinder or center supply, the pressure in cylinders is very high. If you give 2000 psi or 760 psi to the patient, that will lead to bursting of everything. So pressure has to be reduced. So there are some pressure reducing valves which reduce the pressure. After that, gases will come to this part. This is very important part. This part. This part is called as rotameter. And you can see these flow knobs, these knobs. By rotating these knobs clockwise or anticlockwise, you can decrease the or increase the flow through these flow meter tubes. So you can see these transparent, these flow meter tubes. So you rotate this gas, I'll show you. You rotate this knob, more gas will come. And so if you want to increase the flow, keep on rotating. And if you rotate anticlockwise, flow will decrease. So that is how you can adjust the flow rates, means how much anesthetic gas flow should be there. That can be controlled with rotameter. After rotameter, all these anesthetic gases, they will pass through this equipment which is called as vaporizer. So vaporizer is the equipment which contains inhalational agents: halothane, isoflurane, desflurane, sevoflurane. So these gases, when passed through this vaporizer, this inhalation agent will mix with gas mixture, and then this final mixture will be delivered from machine outlet. This is machine outlet. Or if you are using closed circuit, then it will be delivered through here. Okay. And this anesthetic gas mixture which is coming from machine outlet is called as fresh gas flow. So this is a very important term you should understand. Fresh gas flow is the final mixture which is coming from machine outlet, and it usually consists of 75% nitrous oxide or air. Nowadays, many people avoid nitrous oxide. Why? Because nitrous oxide is detrimental to ozone. It is responsible for ozone depletion for global warming. That is why anesthetists who are environment friendly, they avoid nitrous oxide. Then 20% oxygen. And in addition to that, I told you we are using inhalation agent. So this is a combination which is usually used to maintain the anesthesia. 75% nitrous oxide or air plus 25% oxygen and one of the inhalation agent. Okay, so now I think we can easily identify anesthesia workstation. Circuit. A few important things about circuit you should know. So you have seen. So just I'll tell you that these anesthetic gases from cylinder or central supply. Central supply is at a pressure of 60 psi. So it will then pass through pressure reducing valves and it will pass through rotameter. So gases in cylinder or central supply passes through rotameter and after rotameter passes through vaporizer. And after passing through vaporizer, they come at the machine outlet. So they have come at the machine outlet here. Now, but we have to deliver to the patient. So for that you need some tubing. There should be some tube which should deliver these gases to the patient. So these tubings are called as breathing circuits. Okay. So I told you breathing circuit can be semi-closed and closed. This is closed. I'll tell you what this closed or semi-closed is. So breathing circuit can be open, means open, semi-open are obsolete, so no need to discuss. We are discussing only semi-closed and closed circuits. So nowadays we are using only semi-closed and closed circuits. So semi-closed circuits, they were described by the scientist Mefelson. So they are also called as Mefelson circuits. Semi-closed or described by scientist Mefelson. So they are called as Mefelson circuits. Now Mefelson A is called as McGill circuit. So it is simply like this. Again, we will not go in much detail, just to give an idea. So fresh gases, so this is the machine and means this end will be connected to machine. If this end is connected to machine, obviously this end will be connected to patient and this is expiratory valve. Okay. So fresh gases coming from anesthesia machine will be delivered to the patient. Now expiratory gases, which I am drawing here as these glittering lines. So most of these expiratory gases will vent out into the atmosphere through this expiratory valve. But some of these gases will go back into the tubing. Now these gases which has gone back into the tubing means will cause rebreathing. Means patient is rebreathing his expired gases, but we never want. We never want that patient should rebreathe these expired gases. So aim of every circuit is that there should not be any rebreathing. And for that you have to maintain certain flow, means gases coming from anesthesia machine should be significant enough first to push this expiratory gases out of this expiratory valve and then to be delivered to the patient. And this fresh gas flow recommendations for this McGill circuit is, so it is usually used for, it is circuit of choice for spontaneously breathing patient. It is preferred for spontaneously breathing patient. And to prevent this rebreathing, fresh gas flow coming from anesthesia machine should be equal to the minute volume. So what is the minute volume? Minute volume is tidal volume into respiratory rate. So for a young adult male, it is around 6 liter. This means the gas is coming from anesthesia machine should be at least 6 liter. Then only you will be able to prevent rebreathing. Now, B and C are obsolete circuits, no more used. So, this Mefalsan actually has classified A to F. A to F. So, A I told you is Magil. B and C obsolete. Mefalsan D is like this. So this is for fresh gas flow. So Mefalsan D as such was not a big advantage, but a modification in Mefalsan D was made by scientist Bain. And what modification he made? He incorporated an inner tube into this outer tube. Now you can see fresh gases will go through the inner tube and expiratory gases through the outer tube. So point of mixing will be only this small point. So this circuit became very popular, so and so that this is most commonly used nowadays. And as far as fresh gas flow is concerned, it is preferred for circuit of choice for controlled ventilation. What do you mean by controlled ventilation? Controlled ventilation, as the name suggests, means you are controlling the ventilation of the patient. Means patient is paralyzed, and this usually happen in general anesthesia. In general anesthesia, you know, we paralyze the patient. So patient is paralyzed, so your ventilator is controlling the ventilation of the patient. So for controlled ventilation, fresh gas flow should be 1.6 times of minute volume. Means if you are using Bain circuit, how much fresh gas flow from anesthesia machine should come to prevent this rebreathing? 1.6 times of minute volume. Means 1.6 times of 6 liter. So around you can say 9.6 liter, around 10 liter. So Mefalsan E and Mefalsan D are pediatric circuits. So Mefalsan E was just a T-piece to which a tube is attached by a scientist, that is IRS. But it is not a complete circuit. It doesn't have a breathing bag. While you can see that there is breathing bag. So this breathing bag is required to ventilate the patient. There is no breathing bag in Mefalsan E. So obviously it's not a complete circuit. So a breathing bag is attached by a scientist, that is Jackson and Rees, which is called as Mefalsan F. So Mefalsan F is most commonly used pediatric circuit. In fact, I will say that this is in fact the only, you can say, pediatric circuit which is being used. So with this background, now we can see the images. You will be able to identify easily now which is this circuit. Obviously Bain's. Why? You can see an inner tube, this green tube, and this inner tube is going all along the length. You can see it's going all along the length until here. And Bain's, I told you, used for just to summarize, controlled ventilation and fresh gas flow should be 1.6 times of minute volume. Fresh gas flow should be 1.6 times of minute volume. This also you can identify. This is a pediatric circuit. Obviously, the bag size automatically can tell you it's a pediatric circuit, small bag. And this is a T-piece, you can see. To this T-piece, a tubing was attached by scientists. Iris, but that's not a complete circuit, I told you. But a bag was attached by Jackson Rees, making it as Nepholson F. Okay. So Jackson and Rees, which is also called as Nepholson F. And this is most commonly used. Pediatric semi-closed circuit. Second, I told you is closed circuit. Second kind of circuit that is used is closed circuit. So closed circuit is like this. And why I'm making you understand so that you can start, you can identify images if they are asked in any manner, you can see. So this is, will be attached to the patient, and this is the expiratory limb of closed circuit, and this is inspiratory limb, and this is the canister containing soda lime. Okay, so expiratory gases of the patient will pass through this expiratory limb, and from there it will pass through the soda lime. And what the soda lime will do, it will absorb carbon dioxide from these gases, and the same gases can be reused by a patient. Now gases are not venting out into the atmosphere, where we can see here all these gases are venting out into the atmosphere, semi-closed circuit. Expiratory gases will vent out into the atmosphere, but here from here gases are not venting out into the atmosphere, and that is why these circuits are called as closed circuits. How to identify? I will show you. See, this is a closed circuit. You can see this is the inspiratory limb, this is the expiratory limb, and this is the canister containing soda lime. Okay, now you can have an idea about closed circuit. Now, what is this? The most basic equipment for resuscitation, that is called as Emboo bag. I think all of you would have used Emboo bag. Emboo stands for artificial manual breathing unit. Artificial manual breathing unit. Emboo bag. And usually it is available in three capacities: 1.2 liter for adults, 500 ml for pediatric, and very small 250 ml for neonates. Or newborns, this capacity. So this is adult Emboo bag, and obviously many of you would have used Emboo bag to resuscitate. So mask will be hold like that, and then you will press the bag. So obviously this is used for resuscitation. So this is very important and a basic equipment that you should be able to identify. Now what is this? I think many of you would have used this. This is again a very important, you can say, basic component of resuscitation. What is the most important cause of airway obstruction in an unconscious patient? That is tongue fall. Tongue fall means tongue falling back on posterior pharyngeal wall. And to prevent this tongue fall, we use this airway, which is called as Goodell's airway. So it is placed in oral cavity so that this part lies in oropharynx. So this will prevent tongue. So this is like structure tongue. And say this is posterior pharyngeal wall. So it will prevent tongue falling back on posterior pharyngeal wall and preventing the obstruction. And you can see this is a hollow part. This is hollow. So oxygen will be delivered through this hollow part. Okay. So Goodell's airway is used, you can say, simply to prevent tongue fall, or other words, you can say that is to prevent airway obstruction. To prevent the airway obstruction. So this is again one of a very basic equipment that you should know. Now this Goodell's airway can be used to prevent tongue fall, or you can say to prevent airway obstruction. We have a special kind of airways which can be used even to identify to ventilate the patient. And very popular among this is laryngeal mask airway. In fact, if you ask me, most important topic in which you see question on every exam is laryngeal mask airway. So this is laryngeal mask airway. You can see this tube, you can see this cuff, and you can see these ventilation poles or ventilation holes. And this is a system to inflate this cuff. So you can see also, this is LME. This is a tube, this is cuff, and this cuff can be inflated with large volume of air. You inflate this and it will seal the, it will inflate the cuff. Now how it works? So you have to simply place it blindly in oral cavity so that this part, cuff part, lies in oropharynx or hypopharynx. Now if you ventilate through this tube, through these ventilation holes, air has no option but to go to larynx. Like if you ventilate through this tube, through these ventilation holes, air has no option but to go to larynx, because it cannot go anywhere, because other part of the hypopharynx or oropharynx is totally blocked by this cuff. So basically, when it was manufactured, its use was for emergency airway management for failed or difficult intubation. If you are not able to intubate, then as an alternative you can place LME, because intubation, if difficult, then the alternative, very good alternative, is LME. Not able to intubate, no problem, place this laryngeal mask here, and it actually has saved number of lives. If you're not able to intubate the patient, not able to even ventilate the patient with mask, LMA come as a life savior. Okay. But over the years, when we started to use LMA, we found it to be so effective method of ventilation that nowadays we are using it routinely for surgical procedures. So nowadays, used routinely as alternative to intubation, because intubation carries its plethora of complications. So to avoid these complications, we are nowadays routinely using laryngeal mask airway. But the disadvantage, it is not blocking the esophagus. See, it is just lying over the esophagus, not blocking this. So air can still leak from sides, can enter esophagus, can increase intragastric pressure, increasing the risk of aspiration. So the biggest disadvantage is increase risk of aspiration. Increase risk of aspiration. Now, and another problem is, you are clearly seeing that patient's stomach is getting distended. You cannot deflate also. How will you deflate? From where you will pass your suction catheter rise tube, because cuff has occupied the whole oropharynx from where you will pass your suction catheter or Ryle's tube. So that's another disadvantage. But this problem does not exist nowadays, because nowadays we are using second generation LMA. We are using second generation laryngeal mask airway. And the prototype of second generation LMA is ProSeal. So they are important. So they may ask you to identify. This is ProSeal. So the advantage of ProSeal over this conventional classical LMA is, you can see that there is separate port for stomach decompression. Can you see? So you can pass your suction catheter Ryle's tube through this tube, and then through this hole it will enter the esophagus. So advantage of ProSeal, you can clearly see that there is a separate tube for stomach deflation, stomach decompression. Now, cuff carries its problem. By chance, if this cuff get deflated accidentally, then it will rotate, it can block the airway. Or when you are taking it out, patient is in light anesthesia, he can bite and damage your cuff. So these cuff related problems are obviated because of this special kind of laryngeal mask airway, which is called as iGel, which is very commonly used in India. So you can clearly see it has a pre-filled gel. Pre-filled gel cuff. So cuff is pre-filled with gel. So all these cuff related problems can be avoided. And since it is a type of second generation LMA, you can see that there is a port for stomach decompression. You can pass your suction catheter rise tube, and through this hole it will enter the esophagus. So iGel is also very, very frequently used in India. So maybe you can ask you to identify iGel. Then for intubation, you need a laryngoscope. Obviously for intubation you need laryngoscope. And this laryngoscope, you all know, many of you would have also, is called as Macintosh, which is most commonly used. And Macintosh has curved blade. You can see this blade is curved. This is most commonly used, and it is most preferred for adults. This Macintosh is used for adults. There are different kinds of, you can say, laryngoscope blades are available, but obviously we need not go in all those details. Second most commonly used is straight blade with little curve. You can see straight blade but with little curve, and this is Miller. And simply you can remember that Miller is used for pediatric patients. So just simply you can remember, no need to go in details. that Macintosh is curved blade is used for adults, while Miller, which is largely straight blade, straight with curved tip, you can say, straight blade with curved tip is used for pediatric. So by chance, they may ask you, they may just give you this image and simply they can ask you for which age group you will be using this kind of blade. So Macintosh for adults, while Miller for pediatric. That's it. There are different kinds. Now forget all those different kinds. Now endotracheal tube. Obviously, this is endotracheal tube used for obviously intubation, and this is machine end, and this is the obviously patient end, and you can see this is a cuff which can be inflated with this cuff system. And this cuff is used to prevent aspiration. So you can see this endotracheal tube. So you do laryngoscopy, and when you are doing laryngoscopy, always hold laryngoscope in left hand and enter from the right side of the mouth, keep on going down. Lift the tongue and then lift the epiglottis, and when you see the vocal cords, you can place the endotracheal tube and inflate with the cuff. This cuff inflation system. Okay, so normally this mark, you can see this mark, black mark. So this black mark will be at the vocal cords. And then you auscultate, and accordingly you can adjust your length. Okay, and normally for adult males we are preferring 8 or 8.5 number endotracheal tube, and this number actually indicates internal diameter. And for females, we prefer 7 or 7.5 number endotracheal tube. And written also, you can see clearly written 8 number. Means this is for adult male patients. Now, this is also very important. This is called as heat. And moisture exchanger. HME, heat and moisture exchanger. So this is actually used for humidification, maintaining humidification of gases, because gases which are delivering are not humidified. So this is used for humidification. But another important role nowadays coming is in particularly corona time, is it is used as filter. So this all is a filter. So it is, it obviously it will be attached between breathing circuit and the endotracheal tube, and this act as filter. So this is important because now it's COVID time, so they may ask you to identify this HME exchanger, which is a very commonly used filter nowadays. Now, this diagram, sometimes they can ask you, see, we are intubating the patient through oral cavity. So there has to be adequate mouth opening. Then only you will be able to do oral intubation. Now, how you assess mouth opening? This is by मल्लम पट्टी ग्रेडिंग। सो इन मल्लम पट्टी ग्रेडिंग वी आस्क द पेशेंट टू ओपन माउथ एज वाइड एज पॉसिबल एंड बाय लुकिंग एट द स्ट्रक्चर सीन पेशेंट हैज बीन कैटेगराइज्ड इनटू फोर कैटेगरीज। नाउ नो नीड टू गो इन डिटेल्स दैट what all the structures are seen in 1, 2 or 3 or 4, but simply you can remember, you can see 1, majority of the structures are seen, that means mouth opening is adequate, so there should not be any problem in oral intubation. Grade 4, you can see nothing is seen. So when nothing is seen, how you will enter your laryngoscope and endotracheal tube? So obviously that will not be possible, oral intubation will not be possible. Then you have to either go through nasal intubation or patient may even require tricostomy. So simply you can remember, if they give you this kind of diagram, means they are assessing the mouth opening. So Mallam Patti grading is done to assess mouth opening. Okay. Now what is this device? This device is called as bispectral index monitor. Bispectral index monitor, BIS index. Again, no need to go in details. You can simply remember that this is used to measure the depth of anesthesia. Again, how it works, what are the scores, that all details are not required for you. So you can simply remember that this bispectral index monitor is used to monitor the depth of anesthesia. The most basic device, you all know, in fact COVID time everybody has known it, even a common man can now identify this pulse oximeter, forget about medical fraternity. So pulse oximeter. So pulse oximeter, as the name suggests, means measures pulse as well as oxygen saturation. So it measures oxygen saturation, SpO2. So don't get confused, it cannot measure oxygen content or dissolved fraction of oxygen, just the oxygen saturation. Okay. One of the very important major limitation of these pulse oximeters is that they cannot detect abnormal hemoglobins. Means if the patient is having sulf hemoglobin, MAP hemoglobin, they will not be able to diagnose. So this abnormal hemoglobins can be detected only by special kind of pulse oximeters called as co-oximeters. So co-oximeters can detect abnormal hemoglobin. So this is one of the important limitation of pulse oximeters, that they cannot identify abnormal hemoglobin. So in case if there are abnormal hemoglobin, they will give you false value. Now what is this waveform? Clearly written, carbon dioxide waveform. And what is CO2 waveform called as? This is called as capnography. Very important. Capnography is the measurement of antidal, means expired carbon dioxide along with its graph. So capnography is the measurement of antidal carbon dioxide along with its graph. Capnography. And what is the normal antidal carbon dioxide? This is around 3 to 4 mmHg less than arterial PCO2. Arterial PCO2 you know is 35 to 45, so it will be somewhere 32 to 42 mmHg. Okay. And this, what is the most important use of this capnography? It 100% confirms intubation. So you can confirm intubation by number of method, looking at the chest expansion or by auscultation. But even auscultation can misguide you. The tube may be in the esophagus and you are hearing the conducted sound, which you can misinterpret it as breath sounds. Therefore, 100% confirmation of intubation is only and only seen with intubation. And obviously, it is very sensitive to detect extubation, accidental extubation. So what will happen in extubation? Obviously, when the tube is not in trachea, from where CO2 will come out, which you can measure on your monitor. So obviously, in extubation, ETCO2 will become zero. Okay. Now, what are the different components of the graph or different parts of the capnograph? I don't think you need to go in all those details, but just to have an idea how a capnograph looks. And there are many different diseases we can diagnose by capnography. But again, that details is not required for you. One commonly seen thing, by chance, they may ask you, what is this? See, this is a normal graph. If you are seeing a notch like this, what this notch is? This is actually called as curare cleft, which indicate patient spontaneous effort. So during mechanical ventilation, you are giving muscle action. Then how will you know that patient spontaneous breath has recovered or the effect of muscle action has been waned off? This can be very well detected by curare cleft, which is spontaneous effort. So by chance, I don't think they will give you, but by chance, if they give you this, so you should be able to identify that this is a patient spontaneous breath during the control breath. This is epidural needle. Epidural needle, which is called as Tuohy's needle. And spinal needle, I think majority of you would have seen a spinal needle. Many of you would have used also that conventional Quinke back needle. Okay. Then different sizes of cannula. Very important, because if you know the sizes, then you will be able to gauge that how much fluid can be given. So sizes of cannula based on colors, that you should know, and actually very frequently asked. And gauge sizes, you know, are based the larger the number, smaller will be the gauge. So the largest gauge available is 14 gauge, which is orange color. Then 16 gauge is gray color. 18 gauge is green color. And 20 gauge is pink color. 22 gauge is blue color, and 24 gauge is yellow color. So these are usually pediatric, small size. As I told you, as the number increases, the gauge will keep on decreasing. So this you can clearly see, green is 18 gauge, blue you can say is 22 gauge, and pink is 20 gauge. Okay. So I think these images should be enough. From the beginning, we can just revise. This is the oxygen cylinder. You can clearly identify black body with white top, nitrous oxide cylinder, blue body, Antonov cylinder, blue body with white shoulders. Then this is for pin index system. And this is anesthesia machine. Nowadays, I told you called as anesthesia workstation. And this is Bain circuit, which is most commonly used adult semi-closed circuit. This is Jackson Rees, called as Maples NF, which is most commonly used pediatric circuit. Then this is Ambu bag, adult Ambu bag, 1.2 liter capacity is used for resuscitation. Very basic equipment that you should know. And this is Gudel's airway, which is used to prevent tongue fall. I'll show you the real image also, that this is Gudel's airway. So placed like that, so that this part prevent tongue falling back on posterior pharyngeal wall. Then this is laryngeal mask airway, one of the most important. If I'll ask you on which you can expect a question in laryngeal mask airway, so that I will say is the most important invention, if you ask me, in equipment in anesthesia in last decade, that is laryngeal mask airway. And this is second generation laryngeal mask airway, that is ProSeal. And I told you advantage of ProSeal is that there is a extra port. So these LMA devices are important. You have to identify. They can be asked, and in fact has been asked. Then this is iGel, which is available with a pre-filled gel, I told you. Then this is the most commonly used laryngoscope, that is Macintosh, which has a curved blade. And this is second most common used, that is Miller, which has straight blade with curved tip, Miller. And this is endotracheal tube, which all you should know. And technique of intubation already I told you. And another important thing, when you intubate, what should be the position of neck? I think many of you would often do extension of the neck. So actually there should not be extension, there should be flexion at neck. So ideal position for intubation is extension at atlanto occipital joint and flexion at cervical spine, which is called as morning sniffing position. So extension at atlanto occipital joint and flexion at cervical spine, morning sniffing position. And how to achieve this? Simply by placing a 6 to 8 centimeter pillow below the occiput, or a folded towel, a ring can be placed below the occiput. Automatically you achieve this position. So achieve this position, laryngoscope should be held in left hand, and then enter from the right angle of the mouth and keep on going down, lifting the tongue. Once you see the vocal cord, only once you see the vocal cord, then in only place your endotracheal tube. And I told you the best method to confirm the position of endotracheal tube is by capnography. This is HME, actually nowadays you can say HME filter, heat and moisture exchanger. So very important because of the COVID. We are using in fact two HME devices for all these COVID patients. This is Malampati classification for assessing mouth opening. And this is bispectral index monitor for assessing depth of anesthesia. Pulse oximeter, you all know, and the major limitation of pulse oximeter, I told you that it cannot detect abnormal hemoglobins. This is capnography waveform, CO2 waveform, which can become zero if the tubes comes out. And this is a spontaneous effort during the control breath. And this is two-hose needle, which is used for epidural. Two-hose needle. And these are the different size of cannulas. This is a green and a blue and pink. And that's it. So if you still have any doubt, you can always contact us on medical Facebook. Thank you very much, and my best wishes. And in fact, I'll ask you to remain positive as much as during this COVID crisis, because this crisis will go, time will pass, And just keep on studying with positive mind. Thank you very much and my best wishes.